Hey, everybody, this is the Drop the Beat podcast. My name is Charles Larita.
And my name is Will Sarver.
And we want to thank you guys so warmly for listening to us beat off this week and all of the previous weeks you've been listening. And I hope you guys are beating off with us at home. I know Will's beating off. I see him right now through camera on our little socially distanced tablets.
Yeah, I apologize if I look a tad sweaty.
Yeah, the eye contact's a little much, but I respect it.
Well, yeah, you know, I don't want to be rude. You know, I'd like to look at you while I'm doing it. So
I appreciate that. As we're going to be beating off for the next couple minutes, it's good, but we're kind of holding eye contact. I like that.
Yeah.
People are probably horribly confused if no one knows what we're talking about, and you've just joined us on our 16th episode. For this week on the Drop the Beat podcast, we like to talk about music and music related topics in a long format kind of thing. So we really are on dropping the beat. So that's why we're beating off, I guess. Right? Isn't that the proper terminology? We haven't been using this wrong.
No, I think it's correct.
Okay.
I've double checked with my sources here, and yes, we are correct.
Oh, okay. Good, good. You're going to want to clear that search history, honestly, other than that. But no, good. William, how are you this week? What's going on at the Casa de Sarver? That was best Spanish I could do.
It was flawless.
Thanks, bud.
You know, living the dream, doing a whole lot of nothing.
I say living inside. The dream. That's what we all say when we're sad and bored.
Yeah, spot on.
Oh, all right. Nice.
I'm hanging in. I'm doing well. How about yourself?
You know, living that dream.
Oh, I get it now.
Yeah, doing the best we can over here, working on all sorts of fun stuff, not, you know, trying not to die.
Well, the rat cave is it's quite busy these days, I see.
It is. We have lots of video stuff coming out. We're trying to get more weekly stuff going. You and I collaborating on some stuff, getting a lot of the other band guys involved. I think it's good. I think it's something we could do in the meantime before we get everyone back together to start recording again and new music and all that good stuff.
Can't wait.
Oh, I'm so, so excited. But William, we got a question was written in this week.
Interesting. I didn't know that was a thing. I didn't know we did that.
Yeah, so I don't know. Oh, really?
No, I thought we just kept beating off here.
Oh, well, let me fill you in then for your first time knowing about this. If anyone out there listening would like to write in a music or music-related topic to us to discuss in a long format kind of setting like this, you can go to charleslarita.com/contact, fill out the little form with your name, your location, and your question, and we would love to answer it for you and talk about it because apparently we're some kind of musical authority, I guess, self-appointed. But if we do pick your question to talk about on the show, because we like it more than everyone else's shitty questions, we will send you a free Mischief shirt that you can wear. So you no longer have to be, yeah. So you no longer have to be naked and or topless in public while visiting your grandmother, while robbing a bank, while anything. It's really you can't lose, honestly.
It's such a nice gesture.
I think it's a good kind of little trade-off there for writing and listening, and we're just appreciative, so we like kind of sending stuff out for our friends and fans and family and supporters and all that kind of stuff. But we have a question, and I don't know, geographically this might be the farthest so far, because I know we had Canada, but I'm not sure distance-wise between where in Canada that was versus this, but we have someone writing in from Nevada.
That place does sound familiar.
It is in the United States.
It is. Okay.
It is.
Sure. Yeah. Glad we clarified.
It's in the United States. It's in North America, which is cool, as opposed to West America and East America.
Perfect.
My geography is really, really spot on. But Sam writes in from Nevada. Sam wrote in this week, so I think Sam had a very good, very cool question, very current, relevant question. And I think that's why I liked it so much. And I was like, yo, we sending him a shirt.
We got to. I actually know a Sam from Nevada. It's really interesting.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I bet he's a real swell fella.
He is. It's just quite a quinky-dink that another Sam from Nevada is writing in.
I was going to say, that can't possibly be true, though.
I know. So it's definitely not the one I'm thinking about.
I think it's 5,000% the one you're thinking of.
Oh, it is? Okay.
It is, and I'm happy that he wrote in, which is fantastic.
He's the best.
He is. Sam is the man, so we're thankful that Sam had written in this, because it's a great question, which makes me happy that he's been listening and he's been thinking about what to write in, which is really, really cool. So Sam goes on to write, what are your thoughts on what the local music scene and industry will look like in a post-COVID-19 world? What will be different? What new challenges will everyone be facing, and what new or different opportunities will surface? And that is so damn relevant. That is literally the reason, the main reason for us starting this podcast, why we're socially distanced still, why I haven't seen you since February.
That is a good point. Wow.
You know,
that question is real. That is, we're living
because,
it.
Because, yeah, I mean, it's ruling our world at this point. And kind of everything we're doing is because of that. And, man, the arts and performance just all over the world have really taken a hit. I mean, globally. I mean, if we were to look at some of the worst things that could have happened in the performance area and industry of the world with music and whichever, you know, God, I mean, like Broadway closed down. That's insane. Yeah. You know, I mean, obviously everything is to benefit people being safe, and that's the most important thing. And there's so many people out there questioning, and obviously we don't want to ever get political on this kind of thing, but that's what people need to realize, is this virus is not political. It has nothing to do with politics, and that's what people don't understand. People think that this global pandemic is to benefit politics in the United States, and that's absolute bullshit. So it's a health crisis. So the fact that people don't want to wear their masks and social distance and quarantine is why we're still in this shithole in the U.S. of A.
You said
and
it.
That's the honest truth right now with this kind of thing. And myself, speaking on behalf of everyone in the music and performance industry, we are very, very pissed and unhappy with all of this, because it's our world is gone essentially at this point. I'm living in a nightmare right now because, you know, time passing is a huge irrational fear of mine, and the fact that so much time is passing and progress is so much harder to achieve on my goals, it is really hard to sleep and like get on with this stuff, because it's just wasting time, because people can't just, you know, everyone thinks it's horrible to obey what's going on, but it's like, dude, just, it's not about you, it's about everybody else. Ain't about me, it's about we, and that's the thing. And you look at, there's a lot of countries who, you know, have apparently a higher IQ than us, and they're already done. They're already on the decline. They're already back to normal. And yeah, we're not, because people are so goddamn full of themselves and they think it's a political ploy or something stupid like that, or they're trying to be dumb and question. That's like, it's like the big, the 1918 Spanish flu, that you had people back then. There's flyers online you can find about anti-mask coalitions where they would meet, and then ultimately everyone died because they all got infected. And it's like, we still have that this many years later.
That's crazy.
Almost, you know, more than 100 years later, we have that still. So we haven't come as far as we have, and I'm sorry for this horrible tangent, but this is just, it's really angering me, because it's like, I want us to get back. I miss you and my bandmates and recording and performing.
Same,
and I want to get
yeah.
back to that, you know, and there's just people being stupid, and we can't. So, roundabout way of saying it, yeah, Broadway closed down. That sucks. There's so many tours that have stopped for bands. I mean, venues are closed.
Yeah.
You know, gigging is low and impossible. I mean, there are people gigging now, but I mean, there's lots of places I've been seeing where they're not socially distant, and because people think it's going to be like a speakeasy where they can just go in and have a full band. There's people I've seen, you know, within my friends group on Facebook, our parents' age, who have been going to places and there's big concerts and just massive crowds and no one's wearing masks because they think they're just under the radar. And it's like, you're not helping anyone.
No.
Go ahead. I got to toss it over to you. I got to take a breath. But negativity part of it, I mean, what are your thoughts on this right now?
I mean, it is. Yeah. I mean, everything you said is 100% accurate. And it's, there's a lot of people, especially in the music and arts world, that don't have jobs, lost their jobs because of this. You know, especially the ones that make a living playing live music.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, now what do they do? You know, people are trying to do things online and trying to get by and make it work. But, you know, a lot of us do this because we enjoy playing live. I think that's the biggest struggle for me is, like, I really miss playing out.
And yeah, gigging. I do immensely, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that is super difficult. I mean, but, you know, we're lucky to be able to have the technology we have to kind of keep things rolling in a way with, you know, virtually and, you know, the way you can record in your home is really easy these days, and sending things back and forth and making videos is pretty cool.
Yeah, I was going to say there's some great positives that have come out of this, the light and the darkness. Like, look how many bands and artists are doing, like you said, like at-home concerts and the big Zoom music performances. We've been doing the same thing, you and I and a couple of our other guys.
Yeah.
And it does seem like there is a lot of music coming out in such a negative time, you know? Like it just kind of seems like everyone's releasing music, or they're writing stuff for the music, because that's all we can do at this point.
Yeah, exactly.
And everyone's trying to perform from home. Like, I look on any of my various social media things, and there's someone going live doing something and putting on a concert for somebody, and I think that's really cool. So, I mean, that's what we do in the arts and the music industry. I mean, I think it's we take any kind of positive or negative light and just do what we do and kind of persevere, you know?
You have to.
I mean, we don't have a choice. That's what we do, you know?
You said it. I mean, it's forcing us to be a little bit more creative, which is kind of cool. Trying to come up with new things, or like people are trying to do new things and different things that they're not normally used to, which is awesome. You know, there's a couple people that I follow, you know, big time names that are now just taking this opportunity to, you know, write music and put out new acoustic albums, which is really, really cool, because they're like, hey, I'm going to try something different. I got a little bit of equipment here. I know a few other people that can join in, and boom, you know, you got two albums worth, you know.
So that's such a great, you know, positive twist on this kind of thing.
Yeah, especially for some artists at that caliber. Like, they basically had a whole tour scheduled for the year. And now they don't, or they've been touring for years and they now finally get a break to be able to do what they want to do. You know, they want,
that's very true. That's the other end of it.
Yeah. They're getting to record that album. They've always wanted to, but never had the opportunity because, well, let's face it, the money's in the touring and, you know, they're going to do that. It takes a lot of time, and it also breaks up the momentum to stop touring, to go do an album and pay for it yourself, most likely, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I like that aspect. I didn't think about it that way, where it's, I mean, obviously a lot of people aren't getting paid and they're out of work, especially, you know, your Broadway guys and your bands touring and musicians touring. But it also could be, like you said, a small break for them. Because if it's nonstop, it's kind of like, okay, they get a little time to relax. I mean, it stinks for some people rescheduling tours, because it's like a year removed that they have to resume everything,
yeah,
you know, because no one can follow the goddamn guidelines and they think they're being oppressed, but they don't know the meaning of that word. God, I'm so angry, Will. This makes me so angry, like all of this. I'm like stewing and fuming, and I'm livid, and any other fun term to describe anger. Oh, dude, it pisses me
right
the fuck off.
It is extremely frustrating.
Pardon my French dialect, but like, God, it's just, it's
as far as like the future goes for it. I mean, what do you think is going to happen, or what do you see happening? I know I've started to see a few different things starting to come out of it, but
yeah, I'm seeing some kind of people having to get creative. Like I was saying, a lot of right now, a lot of live stuff is streamed and virtual, but people miss the in-person interaction. And I think people need to understand, you kind of have to take it slow at first, and you're not going to be able to dive right back into that. It's not going to happen. It's going to be a slower process. of getting there, and you can't have, you know, like what I've been seeing online, you got all the moms and dads, the moms specifically with their rhinestone pocket jeans and the dads with their Hawaiian shirts and way too tan for this time of year. Groups of people going back and wanting to just get in these big crowds and dance, and it's like, that's not good. You can't do that at the moment. You have to kind of have restraint. So they have a lot of, you know, concerts I've been seeing people attending where it's, you know, they'll have lawn chairs and they're kind of spaced out and they're outside, and that's good. Or they're doing, you've seen people doing like the drive-in concerts.
Yeah, I was
like,
going to mention that. Yeah, it's kind of a thing.
I've been seeing
now.
quite a few bands do that, which is kind of cool. You get them playing and everyone just honks their horn, and it's like, that's kind of fun. Or, you know, you're on the, sit on the outside of your car or something like that. Like, that's inventive. Like, that's kind of neat. It's not the same, obviously, but it's something. In the meantime to do it. And I mean, it's looking at it locally too. I mean, I'm seeing a lot of people kind of do that now because outdoor dining is the new hip thing.
Yep. Like all the, which the is breweries and wineries, you know, cause everything's outside. So it kind of works.
Yeah. And it's kind of cool cause they're getting a lot of, you know, like every place that has outdoor dining now looks like just a little outdoor villa, like especially in small towns and things around us. It's
which I love it,
kind of adorable. Yeah, it's actually pretty cool. Like, if string lights everywhere and all that kind of stuff, I'm like, I could kind of dig this. And you have, you know, little duos or things like that starting to finally make a resurgence, which is nice. And they're still far apart, which is good. I mean, it's like the distance is such a huge thing because people don't understand, you know, the ramifications of this. Like, people don't take it seriously, and it's like, you, no one gets how bad. I mean, I know people who have friends and family who've died from it. Because of that. And not all of them are old. Not all of them are elderly. Like, they're kind of projecting. You know, so if you have someone singing very close to you, you know, they're projecting a lot of spit and bodily fluids.
Oh, yeah.
Shit travels very quickly. Bill Nye did a great experiment online where he kind of put a mask over his face and he tried to blow a candle out, and he was showing which ones worked the best. So when you don't have that on, shit goes everywhere. Absolutely everywhere. And, you know, it still to this day kills me when it's like you see people going into stores and, oh, I forgot my mask, and they're holding their shirt up over their nose like they smelled a bad fart and they're trying to mask their face from it.
It's probably my favorite.
It's like you're so full of shit. It's like, get out of here. Like, dude, like it's people are just very selfish about it and that kind of thing. Now, I guess we can talk about it because it was a personal experience of yours, but you were fairly close to someone in a work environment who had someone who was infected.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Which is awful.
It's not something you want to have around you.
No. I was going to say, obviously, it's not so much in the music category, but the fact that you had to get so close to this kind of thing, what were you even thinking about that? Because I remember you called me when that happened.
Well, yeah, I thought it was like a death sentence.
Dude,
you know, it's a terrible, terrible feeling that I probably won't forget for a very long time, if ever. But it's just from people not taking it seriously, and you know. I don't think people realize that it's kind of like you're kind of doing it for the next person. You're doing it for other people.
Yep.
It's
That's
being,
what it is,
yeah, it's
man.
Being looked at as a very selfish act, or they're just worrying about themselves and type of deal. But, you know, people need to, you know, get their jobs back. People need to play again. And it's, you know, I think people are just thinking about, you know, just the musicians themselves, but it all that comes with a whole host of other people and jobs, you know, between
you're very right
sound equipment,
correct,
roadies, you know, all the behind the scenes production people, like it's their livelihood as well, and all the people that run the venues or
that's
arenas
a good point.
And things
very
like
good
that
point.
I mean, there are thousands of people involved in some of these bigger operations who are missing out on things. And, you know, as far as the future goes with it, I mean, yeah, we're seeing, like you mentioned, the drive-through stuff. I mean, even then, there's already people already breaking the rules with that. People still getting out.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's just, there's just stupid people everywhere. But it's a tough thing because I can see, I don't know, I can see it being maybe more beneficial for locally because of you can have, there's just generally less people. So it might be easier to go play at, you know, one of these places. But, you know, for some of these bigger artists, I don't understand how they're going to do it, because it's just a matter of numbers. I mean, they're pulling in thousands of people. Well, that can't happen anymore. So,
no,
you know, you're working
not for a while.
Right. And you're working off of a much smaller percentage of people attending. I don't know how that's paying the bills for anybody. You know,
no, that's like a lot of concerts now. They're doing like, you know, 25% capacity. And it's like each seat in a place is, you know, every two seats or every three seats. And
who's making money?
Not a lot of. Yeah, it's not a lot of people. It would just kind of even out at that point, because that's the one thing too. It's not just the people in the venue and the bands and the music have to be in good health and get ready to go. But if you don't have people in the venue, that's a big thing. So it's kind of like, just do everyone a favor and kind of protect yourself and everyone else and get, so we can get back to how it was. Because it'll happen. It's just not going to happen now.
Slow.
You know, it's getting, it is getting better, which is good. It kills me because you and I are in the demographic of like the people who truly do care the most. Now, granted, there's people younger than us and older than us who care as well, but it just seems like you have a lot of people our parents' age where they're just like, they do not give a shit. And then you have younger than us, you have a lot of shitty kids who think they're just invincible. And
yeah,
they are really paying the price, man. I keep reading about people doing these massive house parties and stuff, and it's just like, you guys stupid? Like, what are you doing? Like, don't. And then everyone gets infected, and you have, or people, you know, in schools not being safe. Like, that horrifies me too. I have so many students, music students of mine, where, you know, they go back to school this week by the time of when this is recorded, and they're, none of them are like, they want to see their friends, but they're not happy about it. So it's kind of like looking at how schools are kind of going is almost a projection of how it would go if we let in full-size crowds for venues, because it's a ton of people all next to each other. I mean, everyone at concerts is trying to talk to each other, and they're screaming or they're singing, and that's just spreading shit everywhere in the air. And that's horrible. I mean, you could still be wearing masks inside, but there's always going to be people who don't want to, because they think they're, you know, a badass or something like that, and they don't have to. Or
right.
And the selfishness just really, really kills me. But I think, you know, I think for a while in the future, before they, even when they get a vaccine for this kind of thing, which I know they're working their asses off, and I have friends who are in the medical field or have relatives in the medical field, and they are like really busting their balls to get something for this, which is great. And it's unprecedented to have a vaccine that quick, but it's kind of like we really need it just for us to kind of get back to how we need to be. But I think once that kind of happens, and or even before that, when it seems like, okay, everything's kind of slowing down, I think for, you know, venues and things like that, they're going to be doing temperature checks for a while, and mandatory masks and things like that, and spacing and distancing. I think it's for a while, it's just to be safe. And granted, you're going to have people who are miserable and not happy about it. And I get that. That's fine. And it's like, because I'm on the other end, because it's like, yeah, I want to play for more people. But I guess we're going to kind of take what we can get, because it's better than nothing. And I'd rather everyone
it's something. Be safe. Yeah, it is something. And that's really all you can hope for. And I think you said it right. I think it's going to be very similar to schools and things like that. It's going to have to, you know, it's a slow roll.
Slow burn.
And the sad thing is even if some of these music venues are even still around, because I know a bunch that closed up because of this, and I don't.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they were struggling to begin with because, well, guess what? It's art. It's music. Nobody wants to pay. I mean.
Yep. Yeah.
It's the first to go.
People already don't want to pay.
Yeah. It's the first on the chopping block. So even if they do, if they're still around, I mean, I think you're right. It's going to be mask and distancing and temperature checks. But what concerns me a lot, which does normally, is, you know, these places serve alcohol. Okay. Now that's just, you know, you got to take a mask off to drink and eat, blah, blah, blah. But it's poor judgment, you know?
Yes. And I didn't even think of that. Oh my gosh, William.
Well, people, you and I could tell stories of days of you know, for days about people and getting hammered at shows and doing some of the most ridiculous crap ever.
What? No, that never happened.
Yeah, no,
what
they're
are you
great.
Talking about?
They're great, you know.
Everyone's good.
Nothing like a little somebody shouting free word in the back.
Nothing like someone dressed as a pirate tripping over your stage monitor and taking out your trombone player. That's fucking good.
Yeah.
Good Lord.
So that concerns me a little bit because I think people get, you know, just get silly and, you know, and ruin it again for everybody else. But
yeah, that's the thing. I hate just people being selfish with the whole thing. But I do think one of the saving graces is going to be the time of year coming up. So when this all started popping off, it was the end of March. We're recording this in September right now, in early September, at the time of recording for this. It was early March, and people were just starting to come out of their holes and going outside because we're getting cabin fever, and we want to be in the warm weather. And then, oh, God forbid you don't go to the fucking beach in the summer. You know, you'll die. And here's my thing with that. We have been conditioned for a large majority of our lives in school to think that summer is the best season in the world because we're not in school. So everyone's like, summer's the best. It's finally here. Summer sucks. It's too hot. It's clammy. I get sweaty.
It's fall.
No, it's not great. It's always autumn. It's always autumn. Summer can suck it, man. Oh my God. It's look how angry I'm getting with everything.
I think the best part is that your iPad hit the bell.
Sorry for anyone listening. I was getting these wavy Kermit the Frog hand, and I slapped my headphone cable, and it pulled the iPad down.
Oh, that was amazing!
Hit the bell. Oh, but it was for emphasis, William. It was for emphasis.
Someone, please send in Mr. Larita here some wireless headphones, please.
I just got a new pair of AirPods, so I have to set them up for next time. I haven't done the Bluetooth binding yet, but they're going to be here. It's okay. Going to be great. So we don't have these malfunctions anymore. But anyway, I digress from me being a crazy person. But so in a roundabout way of saying it, you know, everyone was getting cabin fever. They want to do stuff. They want to be active. And a lot of people like don't go, or a lot of people who wouldn't go to the beach or go outside really desperately wanted to because of the fact that they couldn't. It was that whole idea. It's the whole thing where it's like, you know, the cookie jar on top of the fridge. It's like, yeah. Don't eat any cookie jars. Don't eat any cookies from up there. And it's like, well, now what do you want to do? Of course, you're going to get fucking cookies. So someone says, oh, you can't go to the beach, can't go outside. And everyone's going to be like, oh, I have to get out of here. It's like, but you never would normally. But so I think hopefully a saving grace that's really going to help slow this thing is we get into autumn, we get into winter. We're supposed to have a fairly brutal winter on our side of the country, I hope, from what I've been reading.
Snow. Last year was weak.
And it was stupidly weak, man. I think I went sledding no times, and for me being a man-child, that really hurts me.
I want to be stuck at your house again.
Oh, my God. That was the best. So we're going to have to tell that story because I just want people to understand you need to be home and be stuck, and it's going to help. So I'm hoping that, you know, with winter, it's going to kind of close everybody up. No one's going to want to leave their house. They're going to want to stay home because it's going to be miserable and snowy. And that's going to really help slow interaction down because outdoor dining is going to be gone if it's too cold outside.
True.
Yeah. I know indoor dining is starting to happen again, but who knows how long that's going to last because people will obviously abuse it because they're chuckle fucks. But I really think winter is going to, and the colder temperatures are really going to help slow this thing down because people aren't going to want to leave as much. And I'm just really hoping that's gonna help it. But William, if we had a story of quarantine in winter, you know, that's the story of you being stuck at my house, and it was probably one of the greatest days of my existence on this beautiful green planet, blue and green planet that we've had. Would you like to kind of spin a yarn of this guy? And this is what you guys should think about doing something like this when you need to, you know, be inside and be in quarantine. It's not bad to be in quarantine, be stuck with the ones you love. But it's just a glorious, glorious story. Will, would you like to start this one off?
I mean, it really started with the train show?
It was the train show. You can just go ahead, get into detail with this guy. No one cares.
You know, there is a thing as a train show. Model trains, that is. And you know, we went to this train show, and it was an experience. Everybody should experience that at some point in their life.
So really, honestly, my big goal of going was to get the big G scale track to use for a camera dolly, dolly, which I did get, and I was happy, but I also just like miniatures, and I like trains, and anyone who's seen anything I do online with any videos or little stupid short films I do knows I like these miniatures and stuff like that. But man, that train show was a religious experience. Would you call it a religious experience?
I can't even get through it because there was just so many shenanigans. And the, oh man, the people that you come across, woo.
It was scary. We'll save some of the early details of how, when we arrived there, just for dignity's sake. But we went, it was you, myself, and my father.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And
one van.
Events. And one very large van, the gigging van. Events happened. We went to the train show. we left the train show. We got pizza. That was good pizza we had that day. It was a blizzard outside. It was snowing so hard.
Yeah. Donuts in the parking lot in that van.
Yeah. It's a very big like A-team looking van, and my father is the master of donuts in this van. He has incredible control, so whenever it's snowing, we will just go through neighborhoods and fishtail around corners and do just the largest donuts you've ever seen. It is just
impressive,
to be reckoned
actually.
With. It is. So we got home, back to my house, and that was right when I got my little remote control helicopter.
Right. Yep. From the train show.
From the train show, yeah, we were flying. Oh, my dad got one too, and we were flying those bitches around. And so, if anyone wants to know, I collect nutcrackers, not because I'm into Christmas, it's because I'm into Tchaikovsky, which I don't know if that sounds better or worse.
Oh, I thought you were into nuts.
I am into nuts, cracking nuts and slapping butts. So I'm into nutcrackers.
Ring the bell. You got to ring the bell for that one.
It's all right. That was a bell one. This is such a horrible story, so hopefully people are still listening. We were trying to have a competition to see who could land the helicopter on top of one of my 4-foot-tall nutcrackers with a flat kind of helmet hat that he has. He's not the one holding the big phallic weapon. He's the one, he has a rifle,
yeah,
I believe.
Yeah.
Which at this point, because it's around Christmas time, we're flying accidentally the helicopter into the tree. We're breaking Lennox ornaments. It was beautiful. So it's time for William to go home. It's a big blizzard. He tries to get out in his very, very seductive sports car. He had some problems and he couldn't make it very far. So we got him back home. We got dinner from our favorite local spot, Mama Rose's. We got some vodka rigatoni.
Ooh, yes.
We got the potato horseradish soup. We were just in love. We watched Dumb and Dumber. It was so overdue. We watched that. It was the best snow day.
And I'm looking
at that day and I think you left because it finally stopped snow and they finally started plowing. It was like 2:30 in the morning. Like We thought you were just staying over. And you know what, man? I look at that and I'm like, how could people have such a frustrating time quarantining? Because we literally made just something out of nothing. And
right.
It was such a perfect day. And it was, everything went wrong, but it was such a great day. So I look at that and I'm like, man, we can do this, guys. Like, come on. We can all hang inside and make it work. There's no reason why you can't. You got 1,000 things to do around here that you're probably putting off because you want to go to the beach. And it's like, dude, like, it's going to start snowing in a couple months and we're going to all be in and it's going to be great. And you're going to have fun and fly some helicopters around and
right.
just fuck up your Christmas tree. It's going to be perfect. But it's that kind of a thing that I'm kind of hoping will happen as winter approaches and the weather kind of gets worse. Because a lot of stuff, if they're not going to be doing indoor gigging, it's going to stop and we're going to kind of be back in that same position. So Sam goes on to ask, like, to kind of piggyback off of that, what new opportunities are going to come from this? Because we've kind of talked about a lot of the challenges, but like, say winter comes and we're still quarantined and no one's really gigging publicly. What do we do? What's going to kind of come from this? You know,
I think we should just all give up, you know, put
all
down
right.
the instrument.
Good call.
Never touch it again. I mean, some will think that way, but I mean, we kind of touched on it earlier, and you know, we're starting to see those things happening. Is just, there is so much you can do at home. I mean, with minimal equipment, and
yeah,
you don't need a crazy space. I mean, if you're recording drums, that's a whole nother animal. of course, pick the wrong instrument. True. But, you know, other than that, I mean, it's a great opportunity to collab with some people, and maybe some people you've never even, you know, thought of collabing with or reaching out, you know.
That's
trying
true.
Something new, getting approached with new opportunities in different styles of music. I mean, I recently, I had a friend of mine that reached out to me to just, he's been stuck in the house and just kind of came up with a little something, and he was kind enough to ask me to play on it. And I was like, absolutely. And it's,
I love that video. It was great.
Yeah,
it was great.
So much fun. I mean, I didn't, you know, we didn't have anything planned. It was just kind of like, here's what I got going on. You know, I'd love to hear what, you know, your take on it. And I hope to see more of that. And I think we will. And I think we're already starting to see that. You know, everybody's seen the videos now of the multi, you know, screened, you know, of everybody playing.
You got a lot of big artists doing, like Chicago just did one. Sheryl Crow did one, which was really cool. You know, a lot of people are kind of coming back out and doing them, because I think it's, people are trying to just get very creative, because it's like, what do you have to work with inside your house?
Yeah.
You know, so everyone's trying to look at everything and be like, how do we milk this and make it the biggest, best idea we possibly can?
Right. Or learn a new skill or new instrument.
That's what I, you know? Dude, I've been practicing a ton. I've been playing a ton at home, which is great, because a lot of time I didn't get to do that, because now I'm down to, like, you know, less than half of my student count because of everything being closed. So I'm having a lot more time. I'm doing more videos. I'm doing just my craft more. I'm writing like you would not believe.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so proud of myself, because a lot of times I would just kind of be like, I don't feel like it. I'm not having it. And I'm just like, oh my God, I could do this all the time. And that's, you know, I've been writing like a machine, and I love it.
Exactly.
And I think that the idea of being kind of not trapped per se, but being focused is what I think people should look at it. We're not quarantined. We're not trapped. We're being focused, where you can kind of be very finite on what you're doing and, yeah, pick up new skills or just better yourself or learn something new or really kind of get down to business and get things done. Like, I have dry erase boards all over the rat cave down here of just things to do. Like, I have right now the dry erase board next to me, because now it's like I have time to do it. I have,
oh yeah, you know, I see it right now.
Yeah, I'm physically holding it up to you. I have what I need to do. It's the original that I'm working on, the cover that I'm working on, the podcast that I need to edit and record. For GHS Strings, that I have a lovely artist endorsement with, what I have to do for them, what I'm going to post on Instagram, what I have for YouTube coming up, what I'm going to be recording. So all sorts of stuff like that, yeah, where it's like, and now I have a list and I can just check it off. And it's like, oh my God, I feel like I'm making such progress. I mean, the Rat Cave studio was finished in this quarantine. It was built and finished.
Exactly.
Which is great, because, like, we finally had the time, and I'm getting to do stuff that I never had the time to do. And I wish more people, instead of being like, oh my God, I can't do anything in this quarantine, I'm so stuck, it's like, no, don't look at it like that. Flip it, you know, put it down, flip it and reverse it, and look at all the stuff that now you can do that you have time
right.
to do.
I mean, this is an opportunity. Like, you won't get this much time, like, ever again. You know? I mean, this is...
No.
Such a freak thing. And I think you're right. Yeah. People are just looking at it as, oh, well, I'm bored. There's nothing to do. Please. There's always something to do. You got to look for it.
Sorry you have such high standards. You know, sorry you guys have such high standards and expectations, but it's like, it's absolutely terrible what's been happening, but you kind of need to look at it as, it is what it is. It's kind of a reset. Do what you have
Improvise.
To do. 'Cause now you got this time. You have this time. Yeah.
And that's what...
Make something out of nothing. Yeah. That's what I love.
You got
to
your
do.
Whiteboard. I got notes everywhere. I got like 10 notebooks, and it's just
I have. Yeah, I have all my notebooks next.
I know
to
we're the same with
side
that.
Of me.
It's terrible. But
oh yeah,
it's just a list of things I want to do or try and do. And you know, like you know, the Rat Cave looks awesome. You finished it. My goal is to build, you know, my studio here at my new house, and you know, I'm gonna have some time to do that. And it's, mm-hmm. you know, I'm starting to get it in the works and whatnot, but, you know, it's now pushing me, especially come winter, which I think we're all going to be inside. This would be a really good time to get it done and to use it, because, you know, I really want to, you know, it's something I really want to get into. And, you know, recording is such a big thing, and it's, you know, being able to do it virtually is like everything now. It's amazing. Like the quality that's coming out. I mean, it sounds just like any other studio, you know, putting out a big record. I mean,
true. So like, yeah, that's
crazy.
I just love how positively you're looking at this kind of thing. And I think that's what people need to kind of see. It's like, yeah, this is a horrible pandemic and I wish everyone could kind of get their shit together and be done with it. But at the same time, when this is done, we're in a cocoon or a chrysalis right now. Mm. And when this is done, we're going to be coming out like big old moths or big old butterflies, whichever little pupa stage you're in. You flapping and flapping that shit, man. It's going to be
flapping
beautiful.
And fapping.
So, like, you're like, you, well, we are beating off this whole time. So, you looking at it like something like that, where it's like, this is what I'm going to get done. This is what I'm going to do. This progress, progress, progress. That is the best thing you could do. Progress is everything. As long as you are moving forward.
Yeah.
That is what's good. So, I would say, the opportunity to have this time to progress your craft and your art is one of the most important things. Because so many people complain about not having time or not having time to focus on their goals or their hobbies or their passions. And it's like, we have this now. You know, now you can,
no
now
excuse.
For all the you know, the stupid ass people who have those carpe diem tattoos and then they just sleep all day and don't do a goddamn thing. Now you can actually put that tattoo to the test and you can carpe that diem and you can really, really do something and seize that day and be like, wake up and be like, this is my goal for today and get it done. Whether that's doing something with music or just, you know, bettering yourself or your home or your family. That's like, I can't wait when I wake up, or me being super late into the night because I'm a vampire, being like, finishing this mixing tonight, or it's like, oh, I'm going to finish this video editing tonight, or I'll give myself deadlines, and that makes me work so much better. With all the stuff that I'm editing and writing and mixing and things like that, I love it. I really, truly, truly love it, and I'm trying to look at it in the best way possible, even though I'm horrified because the future is very uncertain, and I don't like, you know, all this time going by and not being able to progress in the ways I would like. I'm still trying to make up for it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of, I think, the best thing that I can possibly do. Will, I kind of want to know over this whole thing, over the current state of music and the entertainment industry right now, because, you know, music and performance and film and everything is hurting as well as, you know, everyone else. So on the current state right now, and then what the future will kind of hold, you know, what's your kind of final say on this? Because you always have a good final thought.
Well, not today.
And your final thought is just so much, and your final thought's just so much more handsome than mine. So I kind of want to just, you always put it in perspective so well. So what would you, to kind of wrap this guy up, what would you kind of say of what the future holds, or what you think is going, everything's going to look like in a post COVID-19 world? That's kind of
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a crystal ball, so I can't really know what's going to happen. But I mean, if I had to guess, I mean, eventually we'll get back to what it used to be like. I just think that's going to be very slow. I still think the future is very bright, because this is forcing people to be more creative. You know, because they don't have a choice, like we said. And I think there's going to be a ton of new music coming out, and probably some things you've never heard before due to the fact that people have a lot more time now, which is really, really cool. You know, it may even shape the way, the current sound is right now. I mean, we had that on our, you know, our last, you know, podcast about,
yeah,
what the current trends are and what the current sound is, and this could change it potentially. I don't know, but it definitely could. I mean, I think there's always a correlation between something major that's happened in history and, you know, the music that came out of it.
Dude, that is a beautiful point. Like, I look at the one thing when you had, you know, Martin Luther way back in the day. Where he kind of split the church, where you had the Protestants on one side. I mean, that was your split was your birth of blues and also jazz. And that was a really big deal way back in the day and everything. So that's a great point. So this kind of whole, you know, just idea of there's these emotions running wild and just the circumstance and everything, I think we're going to get a lot more from this than we think, more positive than we think.
I agree.
Out of this. That is an awesome goddamn point. I can't even follow that up. I can just give you, I can reward you with one bell ring if that works
for
you.
I'll take it.
Oh. But I'll give you an extra one.
Ooh.
You were a good boy
Ooh,
today.
Thank you.
Yeah, because the one of the tablet falling on it was just out of anger, and I just feel like the general public didn't
that
deserve
was
that.
My favorite.
You know, it was not my best work, I'm gonna be honest with you. But I would like to thank everyone for listening to the Drop the Beat podcast today. If you would like to support us on Patreon, go to charlesreeder.com, and we got a big old orange button on the homepage, and you can support us monthly on that for some all little fun perks and things, you know, included with that little fun stuff. And we're always thankful for everyone who supports us on Patreon. If not, we still love you just the same. I don't know if Will does, but I know I do at least.
Oh, I do. Much love.
Okay, yeah. Good. I'm just making sure. And again, if you guys would like to submit a topic for us to discuss in a long format kind of setting like this, go to charlesloretta.com/contact, and you can submit your name, where you're from, and your question for us. And if we like what you're writing in, we will send you a free shirt. So, Sam, we're going to get in contact with you, and we're going to figure out what size, what you want on this kind of thing, and we will be sending that out to you very soon. But again, guys, thank you so much for listening. Hope everyone is staying safe out there. Wear your mask, wash your hands, don't be a goddamn idiot, because we want to play for people again. I miss my bandmates. I miss seeing everybody, you know. But I this entire time, I have been Charles Loretta.
And I've been Will Sarver.
And thank you guys so much. We'll catch you next time.